Hello everybody, my name is Phaethodas. This is the second video build guide video for the build Diablo 2's Javazon, which is a tribute build for the class Amazon of Diablo 2 game, a game that everybody knows. At least everybody, every gamer, everyone who plays action RPG games, this genre, anyway. So, this is the second video because this is the first update video to the base video, which was the first video. Down in the description you will find a link for the first video of the build guide. If you want to watch it, you can click the link and go watch it. Now let's see with the skills first, the changes, and then we will go to the items. Check. So In the Storm Mastery first, we have maxed out all the skills, the Storm Nimbus, the Heart of Frost, which is a very nice skill because enemies that are inside the radius of this skill are slowed down their movement and attack, so it is easier for us to kill them, and the Static Charge skill, which deals lightning and electrical burn damage. Also, we have maxed out the Storm Surge skill. This is a great skill for melee characters, for melee builds, because when enemies land a hit on our hero, this skill gets activated and it deals lightning damage, cold damage, and also it stuns our enemies for 1.5 seconds on level 12. Which means when they get stunned, it is easier for us to kill them faster. We get an advantage over them for 1.5 seconds. And also in the epic difficulty, I have activated the Squall skill. This is a great skill, especially when we fight against archers, and especially when we fight against the Grandmaster's Makae archers, because these guys are super, super powerful and they can kill us very fast with their bows and arrows. And this skill here helps when we cast it from far away to those enemies. It helps make these enemies, their attacks actually, to miss their target, which happens to be our character, their target. And when they miss their target, we survive longer and we can attack and kill them even easier. This is a great skill, and at least for this build it is very important. I have not put any points on the add-on of the skill, on the obscured visibility, and I don't think I will put any points, but we will see. I don't know, in the legendary difficulty we will see what changes we will have in the skills. This is it for the Storm Mastery. We have only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 skills active. Now in the Hunting Mastery, we have maxed out at on plus 1 the skill takedown, which is the spear skill. I don't have any points on this add-on because I didn't want any bleeding damage to add to the skill. And we have maxed out at on plus 3 the volley skill, a great skill, which launches 3 projectiles when it gets activated instead of 1 projectile. Projectile means 3 arrows when we are using bow, 3 projectiles from staves, magical elemental projectiles when we are using a staff, or 3 attacks instead of 1 when we are using a spear. Now, we have the Art of the Hand on plus 10, not on plus 10, on level 10, the Art of the Hand, and I will go, I plan to max out this skill, because it will give me more pierce and bleeding damage, and more damage against beastmen and beasts. Also, we have maxed out at on plus 1 the Fight Cover, which is a great skill. It helps avoid projectiles. And on plus 2 maxed out the Trail Blazing, which gives movement speed, a great amount of movement speed, and 100% reduced entrapment duration. Of course, we have maxed out the Wood Lore. Without this skill, you cannot play the Hunting Mastery. It is pointless not to invest in this skill. We have the herbal remedy, it is maxed out at on plus one, which gives a great amount of poison resistance and health regeneration per second. And we have the monster lure, which drops a monster lure to the ground and it provokes the enemies. Some of the enemies go and hit this trap, because this is a trap actually. And when they destroy the trap detonates and deals damage to them, because we use the add-on detonate. And also, in the epic difficulty, I have activated the very important skill for this build, the Study Prey. This is currently maxed out at on plus 2 skills. With this one, when we cast it to our enemies, it is a debuff for our enemies. It makes the physical and pierce resistance of our enemies go down by 58%, at least on level 10. And this is a great skill actually, because they receive much more physical and pierce damage when we deal when we cast this skill upon them. And I have activated also the add-on Flash Out, which reduces their defensive ability, the bleeding resistance and elemental resistance of our enemies when we cast the Study Prey upon them. So, in the next difficulty, I'm not sure if I will put any more points here. But we will see. The only certain thing is that I'm going to max out this skill, the Art of the Hand. And we will see with the rest of the skills what we can do about them. So, these are the skills, the changes to the skills, since the first video of this build guide. Now we will see the items. We have new items for this character and many, many deaths, but we will go to that in a moment. First, let's see the items. We are using the Thunder Fist artifact. This is a very nice artifact, although this is a lesser artifact, but it requires a player level 45. This is nice, a very nice artifact. It is a 100% offensive artifact. It gives bleeding damage, lightning damage, energy leech over time, a nice amount of flat lightning damage, a good chance of skill disruption, and the completion bonus gives a good amount of flat piercing damage. Piercing damage, we are using a spear, of course, which also deals piercing damage. So this completion bonus fits very well to this build. Now, for the chest armor, we have the legendary the Khan's Hunting Harness. And this is a nice item. It complements the Hunting Mastery very nicely, because this item was made for the Hunting Mastery. It gives plus 1 to all skills in Hunting Mastery. It gives more damage against beastmen and beasts. It gives increased projectile speed, increased movement speed and attack speed, which is very important. Both of these are very important. It gives dexterity points, plus 53% pierce damage, very, very nice, and a small amount of fire and poison resistance, very small amount for the legendary difficulty. At least these numbers are very low, but anyway, for the epic difficulty this item is very good. Now, we are using the Tracker's Gloves, a very nice set item, with the Tracker's Leg Guard. These two items belong to the same set. With the combination of these two equipped, we get 40% bleeding resistance, very nice, at plus 60 dexterity. Now, these gloves are very good, because they give offensive ability, dexterity points, a great amount of attack speed, plus 37%, this is very, very nice, plus 2 to the volley skill and plus 2 to study prey. We are using both of these skills, and this item actually fits perfectly in this build. And here for the boots, the leg guard, we have this item which gives bleeding resistance and cold resistance, good amount of bleeding and cold resistances, a health regeneration, a great amount of movement speed, at plus 2 to the skill exploit weakness, at plus 1 to trail blazing. We are also using these skills. The trail blazing is here. And the exploit weakness is, I don't remember where it is. Where is this? I forgot about the skill. Anyway, this is a very nice item too. So, now let's talk about the amulet. Cleansing Amulet of the Lynx. This is a great amulet. It gives some poison resistance at plus 18% total speed. Total speed means that all of our speed types go up by 18%, which makes our attack speed very fast, as you can see, and our movement speed very, very fast. So I have enchanted this item with a legendary Raptor Tooth, which is a completed monster charm, and this one gives plus 30% physical damage, plus 25 strength points, and plus 20% physical damage. Now, if I put first the combination of this Raptor Tooth charm with the total speed of this amulet is a great divine combination, very, very powerful. But if I take it off, what happens? Nothing. Haha. You can see that the damage drops down very much. This is the damage per second, 2681, and the average damage, 1600. But if we put this on, our average damage goes up to by 300 points. This is because of the physical damage that this charm gives us, and of course the damage per second goes up by 1000 approximately points. This is a very nice, very nice, very powerful combination. But in the next difficulty, I think I will replace this one because I'm going to need more resistances. Unfortunately, this item, maybe it will go away. We will see, I don't know yet. For the helm, we have the legendary Hermes Winged Helm. This one is a very good item. It gives elemental resistance, 10% dexterity points. It helps very much with our dexterity points. A good amount of defensive ability, movement speed, 9% chance to dodge attacks, which is very important, very useful. At plus 1 to all skills in Rogue Mastery. We do not play Rogue Mastery, so this is useless for our build, but all of the rest of the stats are very, very useful, very nice, very powerful. Now, we go to the rings. Here we have the Adroit Loop. This is a great ring. It gives spirit resistance, poison resistance, a flat damage, up to 24 damage. Also, it gives more physical damage, 25%, more stun duration, more dexterity points, plus 10%, very useful, some health points, and the very good thing about this ring is that it gives plus 10% offensive and defensive ability, and also it gives a small chance to dodge attacks. Now, with the combination of this ring, with the defensive and offensive ability it gives, and the dexterity points that we get here and from other items, for example the dexterity points that we get here and the defensive ability and the dexterity points that we have put here, our defensive ability goes up to 1242 and offensive is 972. Both of these numbers are great numbers. For the epic difficulty, also for the legendary difficulty, these numbers are very good. So as you can see, this ring helps very much with this build. And here we have the Mark of Faris, the legendary ring, a very powerful ring, but it gives no defensive stats. No defensive possibilities, no resistances at all. And unfortunately, this will get replaced in the future because of the legendary difficulty. We are going to need resistances, or we will not survive. This ring gives flat damage, 30 damage, very good amount, 10% chance of plus 470% physical damage. This is a crazy thing. It gives strength points, health points and offensive ability, 134 offensive ability at plus 2 to the skill crushing blow, which we do not use. This is a great powerful ring, but it will get replaced. Now for the shield. The shield I'm using is the Hero's Gear. This is a nice shield actually because it gives a great amount of pierce resistance and it gives also sleep resistance, but we care about the pierce resistance that it gives. And also it gives some amount of defensive ability at plus 2 to the skill rapid construction, which we do not use, it is useless for us. At some health points and energy regeneration percentage. Now I'm using this shield because mainly for the pierce resistance that it gives. And the second reason why I use this shield and I don't have any more powerful shield is the mistake that I did while I was developing this character since the beginning of the game with this character. And which is the mistake? Actually, it is half of a mistake. It is not a complete mistake. It is 50% a mistake. Why I say this? Because when I started developing this character, I was putting in the points, attribute points, to intelligence and dexterity. Instead, I should put points on strength and dexterity, not on intelligence and dexterity, because as you can see now at this point we have a good amount of dexterity points, of course there is no mistake here, but the intelligence points are 272 and the strength points are only 349. Now this number should have been at least 454, something like that. Because if we had that number of strength points, we could equip better shields, much better shields, and better armor items. Because armor, most of the armor, chest armor items and shields require more than 454 strength points, if I remember correctly, to be equipped. And this is the mistake. This is half of the mistake, putting points on intelligence since the beginning of the game. I could not put points here on the strength, so I was left behind and I cannot now equip good items on these two slots. And this has become a problem with the survivability of this build. And this is one of the main reasons why I have 50 deaths on the epic difficulty. Of course I have already completed the campaign on the epic difficulty. This is one of the reasons why I have 50 deaths. But I was lucky enough because this shield gives pierce resistance, a great amount of pierce resistance, and with this item equipped I get 45% pierce resistance. Again, against the Makai archers, especially the Grandmasters, this number is not enough because they deal a super big amount of damage with their arrows, but it helps overall in the rest of the game, we could say, thanks to this item. Now, why this is a half of a mistake? Putting points here and not here, and it is not a complete mistake because since the build is using many skills and it is using skills very often, for example we are using the Squall skill which costs energy points, and we are using very often the Study Prey skill which costs energy points, As you can see, and we always have active 1, 2, 3, 4 skills. All of these skills require energy points. Energy points go up by putting points on intelligence, and also we need, for this build, we need a good amount of energy regeneration. And having put so many points here on intelligence, it gives a good energy regeneration. Many times when my energy goes down, I don't need to drink any potions if there are not any significant, any very powerful enemies in front of me. I let it fill itself because of its energy regeneration rate. So this is why this is half of a mistake, because intelligence points are very useful for this build. Very, very useful. But of course it would be most useful if I had better gear, if I had the possibility to equip better gear on these two slots. Anyway, now for the weapon we have the Blood of Uranus. This is a spear, of course, legendary spear. This is a very powerful weapon. It gives bleeding damage, a good chance of more bleeding damage. It gives energy drain, which is not useful for this build at least. We don't care about it. But it gives a great amount of bleeding resistance. A great amount. Thanks to this item, our bleeding resistance is 80%. Positive 80%, which means it is maxed out. And also it gives a good amount of dexterity points, some health points, and 29% attack speed, which is very useful. The very nice thing about this item is that it grants the skill Blood of Uranus. Now, this skill is this here. Blood of Uranus, granted by item. When we use this skill, actually this is a pet. We summon this pet. Chuck. Come here, where are you going? There it is. Come here, stop here, don't move. There it is. Actually, this is the Silver Nymph pet, which belongs to the nature mastery of this game. But this is different from that pet, different in abilities at least. The looks are almost the same. And this skill, this pet, actually the name of this pet is Melia. This is where it says Melia abilities. This pet deals piercing damage and also reduction to enemy's health. And it has a chance, 36% chance, to dodge attacks and to avoid projectiles. This is a very nice pet. I'm using this one because, as we said before in the first video, we try to make a build that would resemblance a Javazon build of the Amazon class of Diablo 2 game. So instead, this skill is getting used as a tribute to the Valkyrie skill of Diablo 2. We cannot cast the Valkyrie here, but we cast this pet instead. Just to have this pet help us with our battles. This is a very nice skill, very nice pet. It was very useful in the epic difficulty, but the damage it deals is not that great, and I don't think that in the legendary difficulty it will make a big difference, at least not when fighting against big enemies, bosses and things like that. Of course, for smaller enemies, normal mobs, it will be useful still, at least in the first half of the legendary campaign. Now, this pet, the funny thing is that this pet actually killed Hades on the epic difficulty. Well, how did this pet kill Hades? Of course, the damage of this pet against Hades is very low. It is not big. But when I was casting the Study Prey skill or upon Hades, this skill makes Hades the physical resistance and pierce resistance of that boss or of every other enemy go down by 58%. And this pet deals physical, it deals piercing damage and some reduction to enemy's health. So when it goes, the piercing resistance, it goes down by 58%, it means that the damage of this pet goes up by 58% against that enemy. So the way I defeated Hades was to cast upon him the Study Prey skill. The pet was firing arrows against Hades and I was running around trying to avoid the projectiles or the attacks of Hades. And why did I do that? Because my vitality resistance is -40% and Hades was a very challenging battle with this specific build. And Hades killed me about 8, 9 or 9 times. Because he deals a big amount of vitality damage and my vitality resistance is very low, as you can see. So he had me one shot. One shot and I was dead. So I had to find another way to fight him. And this was the way. I was running around, casting Study Prey upon him. And the pet, Melia pet, was firing arrows against him and his health was going down and down, and I was trying to find an opportunity to hit him with my takedown skill, because with this skill we hit the skill against our enemy, we run very fast, hit him, a very powerful hit, and then we run away again trying to avoid his attacks. This was the way I did the battle against Hades. And finally, after 8 or 9 deaths, I managed to defeat him. Yeah, this was very hard. Very, very hard. So this pet proved to be very, very useful in the epic difficulty. At times very powerful, at least when I was casting Study Prey upon enemies. The pet was dealing a very good amount of damage upon them. So guys, this is it for the build. As you can see, my total deaths are 50. 8 or 9 or 10 deaths came from Hades alone. My resistances are very bad, except for the bleeding resistance and the poison resistance, which is 30%, but if I activate this herbal remedy skill, it goes up to 80%, it gets maxed out. The rest of the resistances are not good, and on the legendary difficulty I will have a huge problem with the resistances. So I will need to replace this ring with something that will give me resistances, and this amulet with something that would give me more resistances. And all I have to repeat, all of these problems with the armor, the many deaths and the low resistances came from the decision to start developing this character by putting points on the intelligence instead of strength. So if you are going to make a build where you will play with a spear and it will the build will be a melee build, melee build without bows and things like that, then you have to put points on strength and dexterity in the beginning at least, and leave the intelligence for much later in the game, because if you do not do that, you will have problems with your gear. You will have problems equipping good gear, which would give you a good amount of armor and survivability. So guys, this is it for this guide. The next video guide, the second update video for this build, will come in approximately 10 days from now, from the day that you should watch this video. So if you have any questions, leave a comment below, I will answer very soon, and I will see you in the next video very soon. So thanks for watching, hit the like button if you like what you see, share this video, subscribe if you want to stay updated with more videos, many more videos are coming to this channel, and I will see you very soon. Bye for now and have fun!